Welcome to the last teaching unit in the module grid-connected PV systems, which will deal with the ecological aspects of PV systems. In this lesson, we want to answer the following question. How long does it take a solar system to produce the energy that was put into it? Or in other words, how long does a PV system need to produce energy equivalent to the energy used to manufacture, transport, operate, and dispose of it? Both the production and the use, as well as the disposal of the components of a PV system, can have an impact on the environment. There are various ways to examine the environmental impacts of PV systems. One possibility is to draw up a life cycle analysis, LCA. This considers the entire life cycle of a PV system so that indirect environmental impacts, such as energy used for production or the use of raw materials in production, are also taken into account. We can divide the life cycle of a photovoltaic system into the following sections. First, the energy required to extract all the raw materials needed must be taken into account. These raw materials are then processed further. A particularly energy-intensive step here is, for example, the production of mono or polycrystalline ingots. Next, the production of the components must be taken into account. This includes, for example, the solar cells and the solar glass, as well as the further processing into modules, but also the other system components we have learned about. The energy required to install the system is also taken into account. The energy required for ongoing operation is very low, as the solar system does not consume any raw materials for this purpose. Essentially, energy must be used for maintenance and repair work. Finally, the system must be recycled or disposed of at the end of its life. In addition, the energy needed for transport between individual stages of life must also be considered. A life cycle assessment considers a variety of aspects such as raw material and water consumption, but also the impact of the environment. A complete life cycle assessment would go beyond the scope of this unit. We'll therefore concentrate here on one important aspect of the life cycle assessment, the energy balance. Before we can draw up an energy balance, we need to clarify some important terms. The basis of the energy balance is primary energy. This energy is the original form of energy that has not yet been converted. It is often also referred to as an energy source or energy carrier. Primary energy sources are, for example, fuels like hard coal, lignite, oil, or natural gas, but also energy sources such as sun, wind, or radioactive ores. This energy is now converted with losses into secondary and finally into final energy. The final energy is the energy that is available to the consumer, that is, the electrical energy in the household. However, further transport and conversion losses also occur at the consumer. The final energy minus these losses are called useful energy. However, the reference value in an energy balance is the primary energy. In order to obtain comparable results when creating an energy balance, the final energy is first converted into its primary energy equivalent. To do this, we define the primary energy factor FP. This corresponds to the ratio of primary energy to the final energy. For example, the primary energy factor of the Germany electricity mix is in 2022 is 2.5. This means for 1 kWh of electrical energy, 2.4 kWh of primary energy are needed. But how can we determine the level of primary energy consumption? This depends essentially on the energy source from which the energy originates. In the case of fossil energy sources, this is simple. Here we simply multiply the calorific value by the amount of fuel used. In the case of power generated from other energy sources, for example photovoltaics, wind power, or even nuclear energy, this is not so simple. There are two methods for calculating the primary energy consumption of these power sources, the substitution method and the efficiency method. In the substitution method, it is assumed that electricity from the corresponding energy source replaces or substitutes electricity generation in conventional thermal power plants. The energy of the conventional energy source that would have been required to generate the substituted electricity is then used as the primary energy demand. In the German electricity mix, for example, 1 kilowatt hour of electrical energy from PV replaces 2.4 kilowatt hours of primary energy from conventional power plants. As the share of renewables in the energy mix increases, the primary energy factor decreases. The second method of calculating primary energy consumption is the efficiency method, which is also used by the International Energy Agency. In this method, lump sum efficiencies are assigned to non-fossil energy sources. For nuclear power, for example, an efficiency of 33% is assumed. Nuclear power is therefore included in primary energy consumption with 3 times the energy of the electricity generated by nuclear power. In the case of electricity generation from renewables, on the other hand, only the generated electrical energy is included in the primary energy consumption. Therefore, an efficiency of 100% is assumed here for the calculation of primary energy consumption. This means, for example, that 1 kilowatt hour of electricity from PV corresponds to a primary energy equivalent of 1 kilowatt hour. The two methods can provide very different results depending on the composition of the electricity mix. Therefore, when interpreting the statements on primary energy consumption, it is always important to know which method was used for the calculation. We now look at the energy balance of an energy generation plant. Time is plotted on the x-axis, power on the y-axis. The point of intersection of both axes is the time of commissioning of the plant. The purple area is the accumulated energy yield of the power generation system over its entire lifetime. Strictly speaking, this area is not a rectangle for fluctuating generators such as wind and solar plants, as these plants rarely deliver their nominal output. For the sake of clarity, we present the energy yield as a rectangle, with the right edge of the rectangle marking the point in time when the plant is taken out of operation. In any case, the energy yield refers to the primary energy. Areas below the x-axis show the cumulative energy demand. The area below the x-axis to the left of the zero point is the cumulative energy input for production or installation in relation to the primary energy. The red area below the purple area describes cumulative energy input for the operation of the plant in relation to the primary energy. This can be, for example, energy used for maintenance or cleaning of the installation or for lighting of an open space installation. Finally, there is the cumulative energy input for disposal or processing until recyclable raw materials or products are obtained from which solar modules can be manufactured again. This approach is cradle to cradle. The consideration up to disposal is referred to as cradle to grave. Today, the energy balance is usually considered from cradle to cradle. The sum of the cumulative energy demand from production, operation, and recycling is referred to as the cumulative energy demand in primary energy units. The value determined in this way is the basis for all other further considerations. A frequently used measure of the environmental impact of a PV system is the energy payback time, EPBT. The energy payback time is the time in which a PV system has produced the energy required for production, transport, operation, and disposal. Mathematically, it corresponds to the ratio of the cumulative energy demand in kilowatt hours to the annual yield of the system in kilowatt hours per year. The unit of energy payback time is thus years. Thus, the greater the annual yield of the plant, the smaller the energy payback time. A small energy payback time means that the plant has produced the energy needed for its production, operation, and disposal in a shorter time. As we have seen in earlier chapters, the annual yield of a system depends very much on its location. The efficiency of the modules also plays a role. The cumulative energy input of a solar system must be calculated for each component of the solar system. The following will calculate the cumulative energy consumption using solar glass as an example. Solar glass is the heaviest, so not the most energy intensive component of a solar module. Two manufacturing steps are required to produce tempered solar glass, each of which requires a lot of energy. The first step is raw glass production. This involves melting materials at a good 1500 degrees Celsius, which is of course requiring a lot of energy. This is followed by shaping and a first cutting to raw glass with a dimension between 6 and 20 square meter. Approximately 5.5 gigajoule per ton are required for the production of raw glass. In a second production step, the raw glass is cut to the final dimension of the solar modules, for example 1.7 to 2 square meter. After a grinding process, a washing cycle and an anti-reflective coating, another energy intensive step follows, thermal hardening. For this purpose, the modules are heated up to approximately 640 degrees Celsius and then cooled down in a shock-like manner with a very strong airflow. The processing of the solar glass thus requires about 2 gigajoules per ton, including losses. In sum, the cumulative energy demand is 7.5 gigajoules per ton. In order to calculate the energy payback time of solar glass, the cumulative energy input during production and the energy yield of the PV system must be put into a ratio. For this purpose, both quantities must be related to the same reference value. In the case of a PV system, the reference value is usually area. Therefore, we have to convert the cumulative energy demand to the module area, that is, in kilowatt hours per square meter. To do this, we first convert the energy from gigajoule per ton to kilowatt hours per kilogram. Therefore, we divide the value by 3600 joule per watt hour. We get a cumulative energy input of 2.08 kilowatt hours per kilogram. To convert this mass-based energy into an area-based energy, we need the density and thickness of the solar glass. The density of solar glass is 2.54 tons per cubic meter. The thickness of the glass in glass foil solar modules is about 3.2 millimeter. By multiplying the density and thickness, we get the weight per area, which is 8.1 kilograms per square meter. With this value, we can finally calculate the area-related cumulative energy consumption. We get 17 kilowatt hours per square meter as a result. To calculate the payback period, we also need the energy yield of the PV system in which the solar glass is installed. We consider a plant in southern Germany. We assume a module efficiency of 20%. An efficiency of 20% means that the modules at STC, in other words at 1000 watt per square meter, produce an output of 200 watt peak per square meter. For a plant in southern Germany, we assume a specific annual yield of 1000 kilowatt hours per kilowatt peak. We can therefore expect an annual system yield of 200 kilowatt hours per square meter. We now put this value in relation to the area-specific cumulative energy demand, thus our 17 kilowatt hours per square meter. The result is 0.085 years or 4.4 weeks. We would now have to perform a similar calculation for all other components of the solar system. Fraunhofer Isen in Freiburg has done this using the example of monocrystalline PERC modules with an efficiency of 19.9% in a rooftop installation and module production in China. You can see here a world map showing the energy payback time for different countries. The lowest values is provided by a plant in India. Here, a PV system has already produced the cumulative energy expenditure itself after 0.44 years. In other words, after less than half a year. The PV system in Canada takes the longest. Here the value is 1.42 years. In European countries, the values are between 1 and 1.2 years. The low energy payback time shows that the primary energy used in the production use and end of life of the PV system is quickly recovered after commissioning of the PV systems. Even at lower plant lifetimes, it is therefore unlikely that PV plants will not pay for themselves from an energy perspective. Older studies show much higher energy payback time still. This is because earlier solar cells were much thicker and soil losses were much higher. Furthermore, processes were much more inefficient and module efficiencies much lower. In addition, the production location has an impact on energy consumption. If, for example, modules from German production are used for a system in Germany, the transport distances are significantly shorter, which leads to lower energy consumption. Furthermore, less coal-fired electricity is used for production here than in China. As a result, the energy payback time of European manufacturer systems is reduced from 1.28 to 1.16 years for a medium-sized system in Europe compared to a system manufactured in China. Let's summarize the teaching unit. An energy balance refers to primary energy, also known as an energy carrier or energy source. An energy balance for generation plants looks at the cumulative energy demand from manufacturing, operation, and recycling in terms of primary energy. The energy payback time or energy payback period is calculated by dividing the cumulative energy demand in kilowatt hours by the annual energy yield in kilowatt hours per year. The lower the energy payback time, the better the energy balance. The energy payback time for modern solar systems with solar modules from China is between 0.44 and 1.42 years, depending on the location. By manufacturing in Europe, the energy payback time can be reduced compared to manufacturing in China for a PV system in Europe. Thank you for your attention. It's nice to have you with us through this teaching unit. We wish you success in applying the knowledge you have learned. Bye-bye.